Good evening, guys. Welcome to Oakland Chinatown. For those who are not from Chinatown, welcome. My name is Stuart Chen. I'm the president of Oakland Chinatown Improvement Council. So I have the task of welcoming our city leadership. I'm super excited. Today's theme is safe and clean. Oakland Chinatown is one of those districts that has the highest concentration of nonprofits, from Asian Health Services to Family Bridges to Oakland Chinatown Improvement Council to Lions Club, for one reason. We serve a lot of immigrants and low-income families. So we need help. I'm super excited that we have a team of city leaders who are coming here, and we have their ears. I would like, before I move on, I'd like to do a quick introduction of one of the key figures in Oakland Chinatown who has patrolled our community day in, day out for the last 4 years. I want you to meet Mr. Joe Ma. Ma Zuxi, stand up. Yeah. He has been, if you see the vest, if you've been to Oakland Chinatown, you know who he is. He has been a pillar in our community. Without further ado, I would like to welcome the mayor, the chief of police, the fire chief. I'm excited to hear what your policies are to help us keep us clean and safe. So I'm going to hand off the mic to the director of communication, Ms. Williams.
This is off to a great start, guys. All right, good evening, everybody. I'm going to take this off. Thank you, Stuart, for helping to host us. And thank you for everyone here for making it. My name is Brooklyn Williams. I have the honor of serving as Chief of Education and Community Safety for Mayor Tao. And I want to thank you all for being here today, especially on a Friday evening, 3-day weekend. You could be anywhere right now, and you chose to be with us. So thank you so much. We really look forward to your participation. I also want to extend a special thank you to our host, Oakland Chinatown Improvement Council, OCIC, and Oakland Asian Cultural Center, for partnering with us and hosting us today. I will be your moderator for today's program. And the first thing we want to do is introduce Mayor Tao's full public safety leadership team. Each of these leaders oversees a critical component of Oakland's comprehensive public safety plan. This evening, you will get to hear from our Oakland Mayor, Mayor Sheng Tao, the Department of Violence Prevention Chief, Dr. Holly Joshi, our OPD Chief, Floyd Mitchell, Fire Chief, Chief Damon Covington, as well as the Macro Manager, Elliot Jones, who's there on the end. And then we have our Assistant City Administrator, Mr. Harold Duffy, as well as of our Director of the Oakland Department of Transportation, Mr. Josh Rowan. Each of these leaders will be making brief presentations, and after that, I will be facilitating a Q&A session with you all. There are staff members around the room who will be passing out index cards. If you all raise your hands, please. Some of you have already submitted questions. We appreciate that. For those of you who have not, please write down any questions that you would like answered on a card, and then turn it into one of our team members. This evening, we are going to be attempting to strike a good balance between sharing important information that we know that you all are here to hear and to learn, and also getting through questions and making sure we get to as many of your questions as possible. So that's the balance we're trying to achieve. And because of that, I will be using a timer to time our leaders who are doing a lot of good work, and they like to talk about what they do. And so I'll be doing my best to keep us on track and on time and hopefully get us out of here on time. We'll try to get to as many questions as we can. However, we know that we might not be able to address all of your questions. You will see me sorting the questions and trying to bucket them and cluster them. This is our fifth time, I think, doing this. And so what we've learned is that many people have the same question. And so I prioritize the questions that more than two or three people have, and those are like the priority questions, but we get to as many as we can. If we can't get to a question, it's really important that all of you have registered either ahead of time, and if you haven't, that's perfectly fine. We want to make sure that you provide your contact information, specifically your email, in the front table there. That's there when you walked in. And we want to make sure that your email address is legible so that you can get the follow-up emails that will have answers to the questions, as well as other information. So please make sure you've done that. And with that, I'm going to kick us off, and I'm excited to introduce our first presenter, our Mayor Sheng Tao. Mayor Sheng Tao is one of the Bay Area's strongest and most effective progressive leaders. Her family's story, escaping genocide, poverty, and abuse, has made her into a determined and empathetic leader. Her commitment to racial justice, building affordable housing, advocating for low-wage workers, and protecting tenants can be seen in her many accomplishments as a city council member and drives her work to improve the lives of Oakland's residents. As Oakland's 51st mayor, please give a warm welcome to our mayor, Mayor Sheng Tao.
Hello, testing. Okay, great. Good evening, everyone. I will be speaking a little bit slowly just so that our translator can also translate in the different languages. And so I just want to say thank you so much to Stuart for allowing us to, for hosting this meeting. And then, of course, for the Oakland Cultural Center for hosting us tonight. Thank you all so much. I also want to acknowledge that many of you help keep this area clean and safe. And so for those who volunteer or know somebody who volunteer or have done any work to support the area, thank you so much for what you do. It truly takes a partnership in order for all of this to work. All right, so I'm going to start off by what are the priorities of the Tao administration? There are three top priorities. One, public safety. Two, clean streets. And three, economic development. So these are very basic things that we need to accomplish, but it's important to understand how do we get here? What did my administration inherit from previous administrations? What we inherited was increase in crime. So when we came into office, crime was already on the rise, and we were seeing that crime was higher than what we have seen prior to the pandemic. That's number one. Number two, we saw that illegal dumping was on the rise. We saw more trash on our streets in the past 4 years than we have seen in its history. And then number three, economic development. We see that there wasn't a lot of investments into growing the general revenues, right? So whether it's new ways of how we collect taxes. And so these are the top three ways that these are our top three priorities in regards to what we are prioritizing. So under public safety, we work off of a four-prong approach. The first prong, we have to have a robust police department. And then prong number two is a multi-agency partnership. Because we know that we do not have enough police officers, we have to work with the other agencies, whether it be the sheriff's department, DEA, the federal government, attorney general's office or what have you, and CHP. So we're bringing all of those resources into Oakland to help us with coverage around the different services that we're offering. And of course, along with that, we're going to leverage technology. So because, again, we don't have a lot of resources with OPD, what we're doing is we are working to get technology like our flock cameras. That is high-tech camera that can really hone in on the perpetrators of crime. Even if officers can't get there immediately, we'll be able to utilize something that we're working on right now is first responder drones to get to the scene of a priority one incident so that it can start recording and or be fed into the real-time crime center, right? And so we can see these things happening in real time. And so it'll help our officers to actually go after and apprehend the suspect in a more safer way. And then number four is invest in violence prevention. Right, so we have the enforcement piece, which is police, and then we have the violence intervention, intervening before crime or retaliation starts, and then prevention, preventing crimes from happening from the beginning. So that's the four prongs under public safety. I want to be very clear. These fine folks up here are the people that I have personally hired myself to be my executive team. In any leadership, the CEO does not do all of the work by themselves. I have the vision, I have the wherewithal to get other people's money from the feds, from the state, or what have you. And to lead the city, I create a team. And so what you'll see is that I'm talking about the very broad aspects, but then when each of the chiefs speak, they're going to speak more in depth about these different topics. And we are all working in closely together to ensure that the vision is actually implemented. So the police chief and the chief of the Department of Violence Prevention will speak more around the public safety realm. In regards to our clean streets, we're going to get, you know, more aggressive with making sure that our streets are clean. Our kids have to walk to school. So the values that we carry under this administration is this. Being that the grants pass stood at the Supreme Court, we have a new way of dealing with our homeless encampments. And so how we deal with our homeless encampments is going to be a little bit more aggressive in the sense that we will still go out and offer shelter, we will still go out and offer resources, but we will not allow for any more, you know, coming into office, we were tied and bound by the courts, but now that's being lifted. And so if you're on a sidewalk, you cannot be camped on the sidewalk and you cannot be camped in the park. And so we'll talk a little bit more about that, but Assistant City Administrator Harold Duffy, who works on this topic with me, he'll talk a little bit more about how we're approaching the homeless encampments. He'll also be talking about the illegal dumping in the city of Oakland. All of this overlaps each other, right? This is also public safety in the sense that we're going to be using the same flock cameras that we're going to install. 290 of those flock cameras will be right here in Oakland. 480 of them will be in the East Bay corridor and on every single on-ramp and off-ramp. And so, you know, these cameras are very key because we can hone in on a specific car, a type of car. We can pull it up. And then we can find the uniqueness, whether it's a dent, you know, left fender or what have you. We can then identify the possible suspect and then make sure that police is deployed to apprehend or, you know, to ensure that the suspects are brought to justice. And then with that being said, with the clean streets, we're also asking for community to come out and help. And that is a program called Oakland Fresh. We want to go out and do the bang for the buck, meaning bring out the whole team, clean an area, not only pick up the illegal dumping, the trash, we want to paint the curbs, we want to ensure that, you know, the ADA on the sidewalk is completed, we want to make sure crosswalks are painted, you know, we want to create that impactful feel of a clean street for a neighborhood. And then we want to ask the community to please come on out to support us by keeping it clean. And so Harold will talk about the Adopt-A-Spot. In regards to economic development, right now, we don't have enough resources for many of the things that we need to do at an efficient level and or effective level. And so with that being said, this is why part of the strategy is that we need one owner at the Coliseum. And right now, the Coliseum is currently half owned by the city and half owned by the county slash the A's. And so you just heard the news today that the A's have signed their purchase and sell agreement with AASEG, which is the African American Sports and Entertainment Group. And we're in the works right now and finishing up on our sell of our half to AASEG. Once this is done, there will be only one owner. What's really bothersome for me is that we've had three professional sports teams in the past, a basketball team, a football team, and a baseball team. But yet the whole Hagenberger corridor was never developed. So that means that we're missing out on generating revenues from restaurants, from bars, from all the pre-gaming to the post-gaming, right? People are just leaving our city and not spending more money. And so with that being said, even though all of our sports teams are leaving, we can still create a robust and economically valuable corridor in the Hagenberger. And that is the priority corridor for my administration. And so we really got to start thinking about how we invest in, you know, invest our money so that we can create new revenues of money so that we can stop taxing the same people over and over. And that is all of you, the taxpayers of Oakland, the property owners of Oakland. We have to do business in a different way. This administration is an innovative administration, and we're not going to be here doing things the same way that we've always done. We are planting the seeds today so that we can actually have better and stronger growth for tomorrow. And I'll stop there so that we can go on with the presentation. We really want to get to your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. All right, so we are going to move to the presentation by our chief of the Department of Violence Prevention, Dr. Holly Joshi. Dr. Holly Joshi has vast leadership experience and a track record of successfully implementing evidence-based violence prevention and intervention strategies. Prior to taking on leadership of the Department of Violence Prevention in December, she led nonprofit organizations focused on improving community health and safety and spent 14 years at the Oakland Police Department. While there, she held various roles, including the head of the Vice and Child Exploitation Unit and chief of staff. She was a member of the executive team that successfully implemented the ceasefire strategy in partnership with community leaders over 10 years ago. She is an East Oakland native, widely recognized for her expertise in the intersections of gender-based violence and gun violence, and her deep collaborative relationships across the city. Please help me with a warm welcome for our chief of the Department of Violence Prevention, Dr. Holly Joshi.
Thank you all for hosting us this evening. I'm excited to be here with you and have this really important public safety conversation. I agreed to come back and work for the city after being gone for 9 years because this administration convinced me that they understood what a holistic approach to community safety work needs to look like. So the Department of Violence Prevention is the city and your social services arm of our public safety approach. We're only 5 years old. We were created 5 years ago. It was Councilmember Lynette McElhaney and you all, community members, who understood that the Oakland Police Department needed a partner agency to focus on prevention and intervention while they focused on the enforcement pieces of violence prevention in the city. We're a small department, we're 55 people, but we're growing based on grants. And our three main goals are to reduce homicides and shootings that are group and gang related, to reduce child exploitation, human trafficking, and gender-based violence, and then to address the community trauma associated with those types of violences. Right now, we're mainly focused on re-implementing the ceasefire strategy. Mayor Tao's administration came in strong, understood that the ceasefire strategy had worked in Oakland from 2012 until 2019, and had reduced homicides and shootings during that period by 46%. During the pandemic, right around 2020, the city stepped away from the strategy. We could probably have a whole conversation around what happened, but we'll just say that we came in and decided to pick the strategy back up because it is the most studied, most researched, data-driven gun violence reduction strategy in the country. It worked in Boston, it worked in Chicago, and in 2010, community members like you and faith-based leaders went to the Oakland Police Department and said, Chicago is doing something really innovative that's working. And they got on a plane together, community members, faith-based leaders, and Oakland police officers, and they went to see what Chicago was doing, and they brought back the ceasefire strategy, and we implemented it in Oakland starting in 2011 and started seeing significant results in 2012. So when this administration came in and realized that something was going wrong, they wanted to understand, was it the strategy no longer working because crime had changed so much in Oakland that strategy was no longer valid, or were we not implementing the strategy? So they brought in the California Partnerships for Safe Communities to do an evaluation of the ceasefire strategy, and when I walked in the door in December, 2 weeks later, they gave me the evaluation report. And the report was a blueprint for both myself and the police department around how to re-implement the strategy with fidelity. And so I've spent the last 9 months reorganizing the Department of Violence Prevention, promoting staff, and retraining staff in order to implement that strategy. Now, our side of the strategy is case management, intensive life coaching, and violence interruption. The police department side of the strategy, of course, is enforcement. But it takes a while and can take months and months to build probable cause on a case. And so in the meantime, what happens to people that we know are driving violence in this city? If the police department doesn't have probable cause to go after them, in the past, they would just linger. And when people linger, they continue to engage in violence or become victims of violence. So the Department of Violence Prevention's job is to work with the folks who are driving violence in this city but are not arrestable. And we relentlessly pursue those individuals. I have violence interrupters and case managers who have deep roots in Oakland. They have lived experience, meaning they themselves were at some point involved in gang and group violence, and they themselves were formerly incarcerated. So they represent the living, breathing, walking examples for our clients that there really is another life on the other side of violence. Again, it's an evidence-based strategy, it's data-driven. We believe that those at highest risk, it's a very small number, it's 350 people that are driving gun violence in this city at any given time. So if we can identify those individuals and provide them with intensive case management, meaning seeing them several times a week in person and having daily contacts with them, creating life goals, sometimes relocating them out of Oakland because that's the only safe way to keep them alive, getting them re-enrolled in school, particularly for young people, and getting them involved in job trainings. We believe through this strategy that people can change behaviors, can change their support systems, and can become assets to the community. I'll end by telling you all that last week, I had the pleasure of going to UC Berkeley and seeing seven of DVP former clients finishing up and graduating from their internship at UC Berkeley. During their summer internship, they learned how to be community-based researchers and violence interrupters, and they got a $10,000 check at that graduation. And now they're all on their way to working in community-based organizations. In fact, two of them are already working in community-based organizations, one in San Francisco and one in Oakland. And they're all committed to giving back to the communities that they once terrorized. And so those are just seven examples of our work in progress and showing up to make Oakland a safer place. And I'll end there because I heard my alarm and I could go on forever with the stories of the hardworking folks inside the DVP, but thank you for having us.
All right, thank you, Chief Joshi. So we're gonna do one more presentation by our police chief and then we'll get to some questions specifically about crime and safety. So our new police chief, Chief Floyd Mitchell, began his career as a patrol officer with the Kansas City, Missouri Police Department. After 25 years of impeccable service with Kansas City, he accepted the police chief position for the city of Temple, Texas. In 2019, Mitchell was appointed as the 23rd police chief for the city of Lubbock, Texas, where he served until September of 2023. Chief Mitchell is a veteran of the United States Air Force. He has earned both his BSA and MBA degrees in business administration from Baker University and is a graduate of the Certified Public Manager Program administered by Texas State University. He is a graduate of the 236th Federal Bureau of Investigations National Academy, Quantico, Virginia, and the Police Executive Research Forum's Senior Management Institute for Policing at Boston College. A man that has traveled many places and is now here with us in Oakland, please give a warm welcome to our new police chief, Chief Floyd Mitchell.
Good evening. Thank you very much for the warm welcome, and it's really excited to see so many folks out here. I wanted to start off tonight by telling this group a little bit about your Oakland Police Department. I think it's important for you to have an understanding of how we operate and what's going on there. So your Oakland Police Department today consists of 690 law enforcement officers and approximately 230 civilian non-sworn professionals. Our police department is broken up into four bureaus. You have the patrol bureau, which most of you will come into contact with at some point in time. Those are your uniform officers that you see out there, either on foot patrol, either in some type of undercover assignment, or in a patrol vehicle working the different areas and beats. Then you have our investigations bureau, which consists of our detectives. After a crime occurs, our detectives are assigned the case file, and then they're the ones who contact the witnesses and victims and suspects and put the case file together and present that to the DA's office or either a state or federal agency for prosecution. We also have our administrations bureaus, which takes care of the administrative side of the house in regards to uniforms, vehicles, and budgeting and things like that. That's a big piece, and that's the bureau that I fall under technically. And then we have the Bureau of Risk Management. And what that is that's making sure that we're doing everything correctly, and we're treating people with dignity and respect, and we are policing constitutionally, and we're being procedurally just in regards to our actions. If an officer does something that violates our policy, it's our Internal Affairs Investigations Unit. So that's what that is. So I wanted to do that because I want to make sure people understand how the department operates and how it's broken up. We also prioritize our calls for service, and I think that's a big piece that in these last four town halls that has come forward, we talked about our response time, because that's what you see, and that's one of the metrics that you kind of grade your police department by, is how fast can they get to your call for service, how responsive are they to your call for service. So we prioritize calls in priorities 1, 2, 3, and 4, depending on what's going on. Our priority 1 calls for service are the ones that where there's life or limbs that are in danger. And that's when you see the officers responding with their red lights and sirens on, code 1 response. Then your priority 2, priority 3, and priority 4 calls are those types of crimes that are important to us, and they're very important to us, but a delayed response would not necessarily change the outcome of the investigation. So, you know, say you woke up, you know, tomorrow morning your car was broken into, and you go out there and you call the police and they tell you, well, that's going to be a 2 or 3 hour wait before someone gets to you. That means that the dispatcher is holding a lot more priority 1 and priority 2 calls before they can get to your call. And I know that doesn't sound like good customer service, but we have limited resources, as I spoke to you earlier. We have today 690 police officers that have to cover over 80 square miles and police a population of just under 500,000. So I want you to take those things in consideration as we move forward and go through the presentation and we respond to your questions, so you have a good idea of how things are broken up. Now back to the slides. When you look at our public safety, our summer safety plan, I think it's important to understand how our investigative arm works in regards to the reduction of crime. We have our Crime Gang Intelligence Center. We have our Criminal Investigations Division, as I spoke about. We have our traffic enforcement and our high visibility, which you see as the patrol officers out there patrolling the streets. Our summer safety plan, our key goal during the summertime, because I got here in May and really getting acclimated with it and speaking with the mayor, we knew the kids were getting out of school for the summer, and we wanted to make sure that we had a full court press, so to speak, to address any specific issues, because we're going to have all these youth out for summer. Our goal was to reduce homicides and aggravated assaults, meaning shootings throughout the city of Oakland. And we were very successful in that. There's been a lot of information communicated to our public about the 15% reduction in our violent crimes. Those crimes consist of murders, aggravated assaults, robberies, and sexual assaults or rapes. Those numbers are down for the city of Oakland 15% for this year. When you throw in our Part 1 property crimes, those are our burglaries, carjackings, and things like that, we are down a little over 30%. So we are seeing a reduction in crime, but I know that doesn't give a whole lot of solace for those who have been victimized, because you have been victimized, so you're feeling the pain firsthand. And I understand what it is to feel the pain firsthand, because I've been a victim of a property crime as well. So we understand what's going on there. What we do with our Crime Gang Intelligence Center is that is our intel unit that actually connects the dots in regards to who's committing those crimes, what guns are being used in those crimes, and how we can connect the dots using intelligence and DNA and our investigative elements to put those cases together to present to our DA's office, whether it be our county DA's office or whether it be the state attorney general's office or any of our federal partners to go for federal charges on that. Our criminal investigation works very hard with our different task forces, meaning the FBI, DEA, ATF. We have officers on each of those task forces, so it's like the mayor talked about. You know, it's a force multiplier for us, so we are working hand in hand with these other agencies. So when we do identify those people who are causing harm to our community, we can enlist the help of our federal partners and possibly get stiffer charges placed on those folks. This last couple of weeks, there's been a high focus in regards to our traffic enforcement regarding some of the fatalities that we've seen across the city of Oakland this year. We have a sergeant and six wheel officers that are out there working day in and day out to have a high presence within our neighborhoods and issuing tickets to try to slow people down to prevent further harm done by these folks out there doing sideshows and speeding up and down our neighborhood. The high visibility, I believe you see quite a bit of that down here in Chinatown, because we see our foot patrol officers, our trust building officers are also out here within Chinatown, again, with that high visibility presence. We also have the officers that are out here just covering their beats, the beats that are within BFO1. And I'll be remiss if I didn't introduce the Bureau of Field Operations Commander, Deputy Chief Anthony Tedesco. Anthony, you want to stand up real quick? This is Anthony Tedesco. You can sit down. I know you like to stand up. Anthony Tedesco is one of two deputy chiefs. The city is broken up in half, basically. You have BFO1 and BFO2, our Bureau of Field Operations 1 and Bureau of Field Operations 2. Anthony Tedesco is the deputy chief over this bureau. He is, in my view, the police chief of this area, and I hold him responsible for everything that goes on within this area. If you have a problem within this area, I'm going straight to Anthony and asking him, hey, what are we doing in regards to this specific problem within this area? So, but when you talk about the high visibility, your foot patrols, your overtime assignments, and coordinating with other law enforcement agencies throughout the city of Oakland to make sure that we are working together hand in hand to address the issues that are going on within the city of Oakland. Our special resource officers our special resource officers and crime reduction team officers identify specific targets throughout the city that we know are causing harm, and we go after those folks to try to get them in custody in cases presented to the DA's office. That's the part of working collaboratively with our other folks. How much more time I got? 55 seconds, okay. The other piece is partnershiping with our other city departments. And again, you heard from Dr. Josie in regards to the Department of Violence Prevention. You're going to hear from OCDOT and our efforts of working with them in regards to trying to reduce the sideshows activities that we have here. And you're going to hear from Chief Covington in regards to working with MACRO and try to identify those quality of life issues that we see with the homeless and those that are in need out there. The mayor talked a little bit about our technology and the use of technology, the deployment of our flock cameras, the deployment that we have now, we've had for quite some time, of our shot spotter, and the deployment of drones. Right now, the city has 22, the police department has 22 drone operators that we use on a daily basis. We're continuing to try to expand that program by looking at a drone as a first responder program to where we can get our drones up and out throughout the city to help us reduce that response time as issues occur. So I'll stop there because I know there's going to be plenty of other questions as we move forward.
Thank you so much, Chief Mitchell. All right, so let's get into some of your questions. You see me up here trying to sort them and cluster them so we can get to as many themes as possible. So let's start. This first one is for you, Chief Mitchell. So this one is saying that they're happy to see you out and would like to see you out more. I think people are eager to get to know our new police chief. And so the question is, what have you done kind of so far in your first few couple months or two or three months, and what solutions are you working on?
Yeah, right now what I've done the first, I guess, 3 months that I've been here is really getting acclimated with the city, getting out. I've gone to several town halls like this. I've gone to several meetings of the chamber. I've been to several different churches throughout the community to meet our faith-based leaders. I've got meetings I'm attending a school next week to do a presentation to some kids out there. And getting around meeting the other law enforcement and judicial agencies throughout the department, making sure that we have those good relationships, those good partnerships, so we can address crime jointly as we move on. Looking at the police department, one of the things that is first and forefront is dealing with our deployment and how we're going to deploy as we attrition down to 678 officers. That is a big piece. Everyone knows that we're having some financial issues within the city of Oakland, but we're working through those issues and we're making those tough decisions in regards to how we deploy to make sure that all of our patrol beats are covered on a constant basis, that we're operating safely and we're operating effectively as we move forward. again, we started off by, you know, developing a summer safety plan to make sure we are addressing those crimes, and it's working alongside with the coordination with ceasefire. So when I spoke about the 15% decrease in crime, a lot of that has to do with ceasefire and working hand in hand with our partners.
All right, thank you, Chief. So the next question, I'll start with you, Chief Mitchell, but then I think it would be good to hear from Chief Joshi and potentially the mayor. So it's all about the crime stats, which you just spoke about. So people are wondering what the response is to folks who say that the crime stats are inaccurate. So what's your response to folks who are saying that these stats aren't accurate? Second part of that is folks are feeling like that people might not be reporting as much as they should. So how are we encouraging people to report as well? But let's start with the first one. What's your response when people are questioning the accuracy of the stats?
Yes, and this has come up quite a few times since I've been here, and it's been reported in the news that people don't believe that the crime stats are down. I will tell you that when you look at our crime stats, when you look at especially our priority one, our part one crime stats, your murders, your rapes, your robberies, and aggravated assaults, that is a crime against a person. And those are individuals that have been harmed by someone else within our community. And I will tell you that those crime stats are 100% accurate. You know, there is absolutely no need for me or anyone within our organization to come up here and jeopardize, you know, their personal or professional integrity to try to give you inaccurate crime stats in regards to part one crimes. When we say that our crime stats regarding part one violent crimes against persons is down 15%, you can rest assured that those numbers are correct. I'm not going to sit up here and tell you anything different because I know it's true. Now, when you add in our property crimes, the crimes that people can report online, we try to make it easier, and this is part of the second part of that question. We try to make it as easy as possible for people to report those crimes so you can do it online. Even though you report that crime online, a police officer has to go to that database, look at that report, verify the crime, and then it goes over to our crime statistic reporting. We know there is a delay in that reporting, and we're trying to do everything we can to make that delay shorter and shorter. So when we look at our part one crimes against persons and we say it's 15% down, I'm very confident in that number. When we look at that crime and add it that, you know, we're 30% down when you add in the property crimes, we know there's a delay in there and it may change a percentage here and there as we move through the crimes and we validate all those reports. And I've made that clear in several of the presentations that I've given. There was another part to that question.
Yeah, I think you answered both. I think it's just, are we trying to encourage folks to report their crimes?
Yeah.
And if so, how?
Yeah. Well, you talked about, we also know that some people get frustrated and they choose not to report a crime. You walk outside and someone's broken your turn signal or broken the window of your car, and you find it easier just to call your insurance company and have a new window put in. So we know there is a standard deviation, if you will, in regards to are we reporting, are we capturing all the crimes? We know we're not capturing all the crimes, but what I can tell you is the numbers that we are reporting is the numbers that have been reported to us. Coming from other police departments, I can tell you, every city there are crimes that occur that are not reported. So, but all we can do is report the crime that is reported to us, and the numbers of the crimes that are reported to us are being reported to our community in the most accurate way possible.
Last question about this particular part about reporting. Do they have to use the online form? Can they come down to the PAB or the Eastmont Station to report crime?
Yes, they can come down. But what I would say is if you come down, you're going to have to wait and it's going to take longer. So we're trying to make it as easy and we're trying to make ourselves as easy and as accessible as we possibly can. But you're more than welcome to come to Eastmont or the PAB to file a report. And every morning when I walk in, there's a line of people there at 7:45 in the morning getting the reports taken. But you do have the option to report it online.
Okay, thank you. And for Chief Joshi, can you speak to how your department uses the crime stats or any response you have to folks who say that the crime stats are not accurate?
Yeah, I mean, I understand people's skepticism around crime stats and data. I think as a city, we weren't questioning the stats, though, when crime was up. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the crime stats are the crime stats. And just historically, when I was at OPD, the reason that the weekly crime reports that come out now and that are available publicly on the Oakland Police Department website, that came from council and community. So, I mean, the weekly publishing of crime reports is not something that's coming from us or from this administration as something new to try and draw you into anything. The weekly crime stats have been happening for over 10 years now, and it was requested by council and community because they wanted to increase transparency and, frankly, accountability, right? So for my department, looking at those weekly crime stats and going over those, particularly for the violent crimes that the chief was speaking about, homicides and shootings, is extremely important because I use it as performance metrics for my team. You know, it's not good enough for me, for us to be saying, you know, we're working really well with people, we're trying our best. It's like, what impact is that having for community day to day and week to week? And so for us at the Department of Violence Prevention, in addition to looking at other performance metrics, we're using those crime stats specifically to measure performance.
Thank you, Chief. Okay. Did you want to say something, Mayor? Sorry.
Just in regards to gun violence in itself, you know, we know that there's a decrease in gun violence and homicides, and there's a correlation between our ShotSpotters. ShotSpotter records guns that go off, you know, so we know that guns are going off, and a lot of times when someone is not actually injured by a bullet, then that doesn't get called in. But we do see that our ShotSpotter is recording that the guns that are going off is actually on a decline too, and this is through the work of Ceasefire. Ceasefire doesn't operate by itself within OPD and the Department of Violence Prevention. We have probation at the table. We have the district attorney at the table. So we have community at the table. We have trusted messengers at the table. And so through this Ceasefire work, it's comprehensive, and that's why it works. And so you get the deep impacts, the positive impacts, and that's being shown through the evidence of less gunshots that are happening in the city of Oakland at large.
All right, thank you so much, Mayor. I know that, Chief Mitchell, that you spoke to this a little bit. We do have folks filing in and might have missed the beginning of the presentation. This question is about response times, right? So if you could reiterate how OPD prioritizes response, and then anything we have to say about the 911 upgrades and what is the city doing to improve the response times, which we all agree are not acceptable.
Right. So when we look at our communications unit, right now we have, I want to get my numbers right. We have 79, we're authorized 79 dispatchers, and right now we have 69 of those dispatch positions filled. About somewhere between 15 and 20 of those dispatch positions, those folks are in trainees, they're trainees right now, and they are going through a long process so they can get on the console by themselves. As I spoke to earlier, we have to prioritize calls. Just because you are the first in line doesn't mean that an officer is going to respond to your call first. It depends on what the prioritization is of that call. In a city this large, where we receive over a million 911 calls into our dispatch center every year, we have to prioritize calls. So we can know which ones are the most serious, and we will respond to those as quickly as we possibly can. Those other ones fall into either priority two, priority three, or priority four calls. So sometimes there is a delay in regards to our response time, but if there is a delay, please understand that there is a higher priority call in the queue that has to be responded to first.
Thank you so much. All right, we have maybe 10 more minutes of questions around safety, and then we'll move on to the other presentations. So I'm gonna ask you all to try to be succinct with your answers moving forward, and then we'll come back to as many as we can at the end if we can. You're doing great. Sure. Mayor's going to elaborate on the dispatch improvement.
Yeah, I just want to add that prior to the chief coming on board, the city council and myself, we put in an investment of $2.5 million into the infrastructure of 911. You see, what happens at City Hall is that when we have to upgrade our infrastructure, things that you all cannot see, cannot touch, cannot feel, it doesn't become sexy enough for politicians to actually invest money into. And so what we have seen coming into City Hall last year was that there was an infrastructure outage with our 911 system. And so Harold here actually was the interim city administrator at the time. And they went over and realized that, you know what, we need to actually upgrade our technology. And so we put $2.5 million into the technology upgrade. And so now, previously, we were at about 35% to pick up time for dispatch. So the state normal is, or the state best practice is to pick up 90% of the calls within 15 seconds. In Oakland, it was at 35% within 15 seconds. I have done this myself where I called 911 and I got a busy signal. That is not okay, right? You are calling on your worst days. So we must do better. And so through this upgrade, we are now seeing that our call pickup levels between 15 seconds has gone up from 35% to 53%. Is it good enough? Absolutely not. But this is the beginning works of investing into our infrastructure to finally get into that slot one day. Another change that we've done is we've actually brought our, you know, we prioritize and push forward and force HR to actually prioritize the vacancies in dispatch. Before, there was about 20 vacancies that had been vacant for a very long time. And so we're hiring for all of those positions to fill those positions. And then number two, we're training them in a cohort. Just like police academies and fire academies, they work together as a team. Dispatchers, that's an emotionally taxing job. You're getting people's phone calls on their worst days. A lot of times it's about kids. That's a lot. So we're bringing them together as a cohort so that we can retain them and actually invest in our investments in the people.
Thank you, Mayor. All right, this next question is about crimes against seniors, which a few different people have talked about here in the surrounding neighborhood in Chinatown. And so this question is about what kind of messaging does the community need to hear about crimes against seniors, and how can they help? How can the community help with this issue?
Well, I think it's important for us to make sure that we're doing everything we can on a policing and public safety side from a visibility standpoint to communicate to our seniors that it's safe to move about our city. With that, our PIO office, when we have those incidents, when we see that our suspects out there are targeting our seniors, we increase visibility within those neighborhoods. We talk to the community leaders that are part of that neighborhood to make sure they understand that, hey, this is the trend that we're seeing. Make sure that you're notifying your seniors of what the trend is that we are seeing. And we do that with our local media partners as well by putting out public information announcements. But making sure that you're doing everything you can, and I say this, in several of my presentations throughout the city, making sure we're doing everything we can to stay as safe as possible ourselves, making sure that we're keeping our head on a swivel, we're seeing what's going on around us, we're walking in well-lit areas, we're walking in groups, but again, making yourself less of a target as you go out to do your shopping and going about the city.
Thank you. I know that at least with some of the crimes that we've seen against seniors in Councilmember Fife's district, that this is just an example of what community can do. I believe she's organizing, to your point about walking in groups, community members who are volunteering to walk seniors to run their errands, and I think trying to identify vehicles to also drive them. So if you ever see those opportunities come up, would you like to volunteer? Then that would be something as well that I believe is in the works. Okay, let's keep going. This is kind of related. So the question is for you, Chief Mitchell, what sort of police training is being implemented within the department to address profiling and bias, as well as addressing issues of excessive force? This is a training question.
Sure. I will tell you, like I said, I've been here just over 3 months now, and you have one of the most professional police departments that I've ever been a part of. I think you should be very proud of your police department. You have a police department that turns over somewhere between 40 and 50 officers every year. And that's just how the system is designed. When you hit a certain year, 25 years on your police department, you're eligible to retire. So we right now, we attrition somewhere between 4 and 6 people out of our department every year. So your department is pretty young. So you're going to have officers that make mistakes. You're going to have officers that don't conform 100% to our culture, and we identify those officers, and we separate them from our police department as best and as quickly as we possibly can. But we have a six-month police academy. And in that six-month police academy, they go over everything in regards to how Oakland polices, how Oakland wants to be policed, and from our standpoint and from the history and culture of Oakland, things that we make sure that we're not going to tolerate as we move forward. We want to be constitutionally correct and procedurally just police department. We want to minimize bias as best as we possibly can. And we report out on that through our weekly risk management reports in regards to who are we stopping, why are we stopping them, what was the probable cause or reasonable suspicion for that stop, what are the differences or the deviations that we are seeing, and is it something that we can report back on? How many people are we handcuffing, and why are we handcuffing those folks? And is there a large deviation in regards to, are we handcuffing more black folks than white folks? Are we stopping more Hispanic folks than Asian folks, and why? And because we are a diverse community, and it's important that we pay attention to these metrics and this data so we can quickly see if something is jumping off the page to us, and we can take the corrective action, whether that's putting that officer on a performance improvement plan or separating or discipline that officer based on some actions that we saw. But there are several processes that are in place in Oakland that I have not seen in other police departments that help us identify and ensure that when we do see that bias, we are addressing it as best as we possibly can.
All right, thank you, Chief Mitchell. So a couple of questions about walking officers. It's interesting because one question is saying, why don't we have regular police presence foot patrol in Chinatown? And then the next question is, why don't we see more police officers in East Oakland like we do in Chinatown? So I think everyone's feeling like there's not enough. But can you confirm if there are foot patrols in Chinatown currently?
Yeah, so I will tell you there are foot patrols in Chinatown. We also have a trust building officer here, but I know there's some different administrative things going around right now in regards to where officers are assigned and if officers are going to be replaced based on different issues that we face throughout the community. But just like I started off with, we are currently at 690 police officers for the city of Oakland. This is a big city for that many, to have that few, I will say, police officers. We know that the Office of Inspector General is doing a study right now to help us better communicate to our council and to the public what we believe the proper number of police officers should be throughout the city of Oakland. We expect to get that report at the end of the year. I will tell you, just being in this business for as long as I have, we don't have the correct number of police officers here to have that constant visible presence that we need. But as we attrition down, we are making those decisions to pull officers from administrative positions to make sure that we have a visible presence throughout the city of Oakland as best as we possibly can. And I spoke about this at the other meetings, and because the city administrator is not here tonight, I'm going to steal his line again. We're doing the best we can with what we have, and we're going to continue to do everything we can with what we have. It's not about what we can't do, it's what we can do with what we have, and that's what we're doing right now.
Thanks, Chief. Can we elaborate a little bit more? I know that we have the foot patrols pretty much are in the commercial corridors, is my understanding, right? But are there, how else are we promoting and deciding which resources go where as far as police? Well, what's the process to determine where police are placed?
Well, our city is deployed into six areas, and each of those, and within those six areas, we have 36 beats. Each of those beats has an officer assigned to it. Some areas have overtime assignments depending on what's going on within that specific beat, but it's imperative of the BFO commander, the shift captain, and the lieutenant to identify if additional resources are needed in a specific area, and if so, those are filled through some type, either an overtime assignment or moving resources over there for if it's a specific event that goes on within that neighborhood.
Right. So using, that's why the importance of the crime data, right? That's how it's used, yeah, as well, right? If there's certain areas that are high in crime, in addition to covering all of the beats, Okay, this next one, I'm going to move us a little more quickly. No chase policy, right? So there's some, I know there's been a lot of conversation about it. I think some people think that there's no chase policy. What is the chase policy? And there's folks wondering if they would like to see that policy change or be amended, how can they participate?
Okay. The City of Oakland does not have a no chase policy. Our police department does not have a no chase policy. We have a very restrictive chase policy. And what we're doing right now is working with the police commission. And I know they have a several ad hoc meetings going on throughout the city to look at making potential changes to our current pursuit policy. If you want to be involved in that, you're more than welcome to go to any of the commission meetings that happen every 2 weeks. You can also attend one of the ad hocs that is, you could find those on the city website if you look under the police commission. Our policies are, our chase policy goes through the police commission. They are the ones who look at and determine exactly what our chase policy is going to be. I've communicated in several of these meetings and out in the public that I believe our chase policy should be more in line with what's going on within the region. Right now, we are a little more restrictive than some other police departments, and that's one of the reasons why the police commission is looking at our chase policy to see if we can, there's changes we need to make that would put us more in line with the rest of the community.
And I would encourage folks to go to the police commission's website. You can just Google Oakland Police Commission, and they do post their meetings, and we definitely encourage you, like the chief said, to weigh in on this topic. If it does change, we'll all, you know, live with what that means. If it doesn't change, we will do the same. And so I think it's really important that more than the 7 individuals on the commission weigh in on that. It's really important that as a community, we all give our input to see what we'd like to see change or not change. Okay, this next one is about another thing that kind of relates to police and engaging directly with our residents. So there are rumors that OPD officers have to stop their arrest if the person being taken into custody wants to speak with their supervisor to lodge a complaint. Is this true?
No, that does not. Just because you ask for a supervisor does not mean we stop the arrest. If you get arrested, if you're violating the law and the officer is arresting you and you say that you want to speak to a supervisor, we'll have a supervisor come out there and take your complaint. But that does not mean you do not go to jail.
Okay, thank you. Appreciate the brevity. Just get there, you know? All right, so this next one, flock cameras. What's the status? When are they going to be installed? How many? It's as succinct as possible, everybody.
I can talk about it, or Mayor, you want to talk about it. Okay, I didn't know if they got tired of hearing my voice yet. Our flock cameras, we have 290 cameras that are going to be deployed throughout the city of Oakland. That is part of the over 400 cameras that are going to be deployed throughout the East Bay in our partnership with California Highway Patrol. Right now, we have just over 100 of those cameras that have been installed. They're not fully operational yet. There's some training that we have to do internally to make sure that we are abiding by the public Privacy Commission. So there's some training that we have to do with our officers before we give them access to that. And that's where we are right now.
All right, great. And is there a point person for coordinating private cameras? Are all the cameras CHP or state or OPD? Are some of them private? And is there anybody coordinating all of them?
Well, there's a lot of private cameras out in our community, and one of the things that I know the chamber is doing, especially in the downtown businesses, is they're working to make sure that they have a coordinated effort with all the private cameras. One of the things that we're working toward is having a real-time crime center to where we can coordinate not only our shot spotter and our cameras and private cameras that people want to give us access to, but just using this from a technology standpoint, collecting all this in one area for the whole area, so we can manage what's going on and pay attention to all the crimes that are happening throughout the city, and use this technology to say that, hey, if something is happening over here, or if this type of vehicle was used in a crime, or this type of suspect description was used in a crime, we're able to use that data, and based on what time the crime happened, go back and find out if we can see who exactly was committing that crime.
All right, and related question, who will control license plate readers, CHP or OPD? And we just talked about when they will be put up, but who's in control of the license plate readers? Who gets that information?
I don't know that right now.
Okay. Oh. Mayor, go ahead. Yeah, I know you've been involved.
So the license plate readers are the flock cameras, and so that will be housed under OPD. However, the database, so we are leasing this technology, and the technology that collects the data actually lives with Flock, the organization itself. And so through our privacy commission, you know, and this was a hard-fought legislation that I, along with the chief at the time, Chief Allison, the interim chief, Chief Allison, worked with the privacy commission on making sure that in 30 days, if we don't utilize the data, that it is completely erased. And that is just for the city of Oakland.
All right, thank you. Okay, so I think that's all on the cameras that I have here. We're gonna do rapid fire. What would the Oakland taxpayers have to do to fully staff OPD? If we want to get there, if they're willing to do it, what would they have to do?
So right now, what I can tell you is that $10 million equates to 35 officers a year. So at $10 million a year, you can purchase up to 35 officers.
All right. So, and I know you've talked about this, Mayor, yes, about the property taxes that we have, yes, here, and that impact that it has on our homeowners and property owners, and what you're trying to do to bring in additional resources.
So I always ask people this. How many of you are homeowners? How many of you homeowners are sick and tired of paying high property taxes? Yes, her hand is really high. I guess, how many of you are renters? I'm a renter. Being a renter, it creates barriers to entry to be a homeowner when you're being taxed on the back end by the city by over $20,000 a year, right? And so there's a lot of barriers to this. So what I'm trying to get at for the city of Oakland is create new revenue streams so that we can stop taxing our own people, so that we can give you all the basic services that the government's supposed to deliver already. And the way to do this is to be innovative and make sure that we develop in areas that have been forgotten about for decades. And that is easy to know, right? That's West Oakland and that is East Oakland. This not only helps support the communities there when you do it in a responsible way that you don't displace the community, right? An example is West Oakland. We came in and we built out the Baller Stadium, and at the same time across the street, we took down the largest encampment in Northern California called Wood Street, which hosted thousands of people. We got the people who needed housing and shelter. But now at that very same spot, we've developed over 100 affordable housing units. And we're going to develop more affordable and deeply affordable housing units throughout the city of Oakland. And so those are you have to create the new streams of revenue so that you can pay to get more cops, to get more firefighters, to get more people to clean our streets. And that's the only way to do it. Otherwise, if you want more cops, then you have to take away from cleaning the streets, right? But we need all of that, so we got to create new streams of revenue.
Thank you, Mayor. Okay, so this is like a high-level question about folks feeling like there's just not enough accountability and a sense of lawlessness, I don't think maybe just here, but across our county. And so I would say, you know, Chief Mitchell, Chief Joshi, the mayor, what do you say to folks who feel like, you know, they see police arresting folks, but it just feels like folks aren't being held accountable?
I could start, and then maybe you could, like, they have a lot of opinions. You know, the key thing to say is that I want to just commend our OPD officers. They come into work, and they know that the workload is going to be massive, right? We have more calls to 911 for emergency calls than San Francisco does. San Francisco has twice our budget because they're a city and a county, and twice the population. But we have twice the calls. And so with that being said, you know, our officers are arresting suspects. Our officers are catching them in the act, have evidence. But at the end of the day, we turn that over because we are not a prosecutorial body. We turn it over to the DA. If they're juveniles, we turn them over to probation. And it is up to those arms of government to whether they decide to prosecute. Even if the DA decides to prosecute, that goes to the judge. The judge can then force them to go mediate and get a lesser sentence. You know, so these variables are out of our hands. And it is very frustrating I've heard this and I've seen it for myself, where officers are arresting people for doing criminal stuff. And then within days, if not just one day or maybe a week, we see the same person out on the street doing the same thing. It is demoralizing. It is very complicated. But all I know is that OPD, What I always tell officers is, we're going to show up and we're going to continue to do our job, even if it's demoralizing, because we're not doing it for anybody else outside of our own people and protecting them. And so we're going to keep doing the job. But of course, all branches need to be working together.
Thank you, Mayor. All right, this one's for you, Chief Joshi. What is the city doing to support victims of crime? Right. So we've talked a lot about crime. Crime can create trauma, both for the individual and also the family and larger community. So what is the City of Oakland, and particularly DVP, helping to support victims of crime?
Yeah, thank you. I would argue that all of our work really is centered on victims, because for our gun violence reduction strategy, today's suspect is tomorrow's victim and vice versa, right? When we're centering on those most at risk of imminent gun violence, like, we're trying to work with people who within the next 90 days may pick up a gun or may get shot. And so many people that we're working with have already been shot before. And we are concerned about healing that trauma so that they don't retaliate, so that they can get out of the cycle of violence. And we do that through our intensive life coaching model. We also have a lot of therapeutic services available, therapeutic supports and services. We support community-based organizations with around $15 million every year. That's your Measure Z dollars at work. And we have a community healing strategy that supports community-based organizations who have licensed clinicians available to those survivors of crime. And then when it comes to gender-based violence, human trafficking, sexual assault in particular, we also work directly with gender-based violence organizations in this city who have crisis management. They have life coaching, case management, hospital-based response, therapeutic supports, et cetera. And inside the DVP, we have a very small 3-person gender-based violence response as well. But the vast majority of the therapeutic supports for folks, both victims of gun violence and gender-based violence, are coming through our grants to community-based organizations.
Thank you. Okay, we're going to do two more. So this one should be really quick, I think. This is about mail theft, which I've experienced. I think a lot of us here have experienced a lot of the stuff that everyone else has experienced. Is that OPD's jurisdiction, or is that the federal government, or who's in charge of that?
That's the United Postal Masters, and that's their jurisdiction.
Okay, yeah. And we've met, when we met with our federal partners, that included the chief of the folks who deal with mail theft, and they do their own operations. They told us that they've seen a decline after some major operations. But yes, that is a federal government, and it is a felony to mess with the mail, and so it's serious business. But the feds deal with that. Okay, this last question is about the Mayor's Advisory Council on Human Trafficking, and it's I appreciate this question. It's very detailed. I think ultimately, the question is, what are we doing, but also how can the community get involved, and how are we communicating what we're doing back to the community? I want to say that I facilitate that council and help to stand it up, and we have three major priorities, or we have three subcommittees. One is prevention, the second one is intervention, and the third one is enforcement. So as an administration, as you'll see here, we cover all three. We need to prevent crime from happening in the first place. That includes human trafficking. That committee focuses on public awareness campaigns, trying to make sure our young people, our young girls in particular, know the signs of grooming, and try to get ahead of it so that they don't get caught up in that cycle in the first place. The intervention subcommittee is working on things like housing, housing interventions. Without housing, you're very vulnerable. The most vulnerable population to sex trafficking are the unhoused and having housing instability. And then the third committee is enforcement. And what I can share is that OPD has prioritized this. The Blade has seen an increase in enforcement activities and will continue to do that with other public safety agencies over the next few weeks. So human trafficking is a top priority, as well as reducing homicides and shootings, as you've heard. As far as how we're communicating that to the community, that is something that one of our committees is working on. We needed to stand up and get to work so that we have something to communicate. But I will say that folks have been really busy. There's another public safety campaign coming up now that school's back in session. So we're really focusing on our young people. But there have been several, and I'm just answering this, Chief, so we can move, operations that OPD has been doing over the last several weeks, targeting John's targeting exploiters. And so we will continue to do that, and you will be hearing more details in the future. And the suggestion that we have some kind of open forum to be able to listen to what community says is a great one. I appreciate that. Okay, so with that, we're going to move. There are a couple other presenters that we have. We're moving into fire and also our clean streets. And so I'm going to introduce our fire chief, Chief Damon Covington. We call him Chief Cove. He's been Oakland's fire chief since October of 2023. And prior to this, his appointment, this Oakland native served in an array of capacities over his 24-year career with Oakland Fire, including firefighter, paramedic, fire engineer, lieutenant of fire, captain of training, battalion chief, special ops chief, deputy fire chief, and most recently our interim fire chief. Chief Covington's educational accomplishments include a Bachelor of Arts in Sociology from Sonoma State University and a master's degree. There's a lot of degrees up here. I just want to say, this is our fifth time. I'm like, wow, this is like very degreed up here. A master's degree in executive public administration from Golden Gate University. Chief Covington was the president of the Oakland Black Firefighters Association from 2016 to 2022 and previously served as the chair of the Rodeo Hercules Fire Protection District. Additionally, he currently serves as an adjunct professor for Merritt College, where he lectures in the undergraduate fire science program. Please give a warm welcome to our fire chief, Chief Damon Covington.
Thank you. Thank you guys for coming out tonight at such a late hour and on a long weekend when you guys have your feet kicked up. We appreciate you guys being passionate about Oakland. We are also passionate about Oakland, and we recognize that in collaboration with you, we're going to get things cleaned up and where they need to be. I just want to give you a little information about the Oakland Fire Department, some of the upcoming wins that we have coming down the pipe. I know you guys want to get back to your questions, so I'll be brief. But the Oakland Fire Department is one of our oldest departments in the city of Oakland. It's been here since 1869. We have 25 stations and a little over 550 very dedicated members who serve the entire city of Oakland. Right here in Chinatown, our station is Station 12, right down the street on Alice. And it serves the entire community. What a lot of people may not realize is that the Oakland Fire Department is broken up into six divisions. We have our operations division, which is what you see most of the time, our engines and trucks around the city who are operating, are responding to 911 calls. We respond to approximately 85,000 calls a year for service. We're an all risk mitigation department, meaning whatever ails you, whether it be a medical, a fire, a grass fire, smoke in the building, birth, childbirth, you name it. If you call 911, we're going to show up and we're going to make it better. And we do that approximately 85,000 times a year. So our our firefighters get taxed. You know, they're very diligent and very dedicated, but they get tired. We need more people as well, so we'll get to that in a minute. We also have our EMS division, which is our medical division. We have our emergency management division, which handles the emergency management for the entire city. So that department would handle earthquake preparedness, CERT for community action and calls to action. All the different emergency preparation for the city is handled through our emergency management department. We have our newest wing of the fire department, which is MACRO. Has anybody heard of MACRO? Four people? Good. Yes. All right. As always, four. Yeah. We're going to build that up. We're going to make sure everybody in here knows about MACRO. And I brought my MACRO manager, Mr. Elliot Jones, on the end to talk a little bit more about MACRO. MACRO is 2 years removed from the pilot. We just finished our second year, which was a pilot program, and we've had amazing success with our MACRO program. MACRO started 2 years ago through city council and through the community with the goal of having a mental health service for the city of Oakland so that our police and firefighters are not put in positions that they're not trained to respond to. MACRO was invented to be an auxiliary service for the fire department It lives within the fire department, but it is the property of the city of Oakland and our community. We want to grow Macro in a way that serves our citizens. Macro is still in its infancy phase, but it is by far at one of the leading auxiliary delivery programs in the country. We've worked with many programs like Macro around the country because we want to know what best practices are. This is a very new component to the fire service around our country, and it's kind of being built every single day. And so we want to reach out to the community and make sure you guys have a say in what your Macro program is going to look like moving forward. There's been a lot of, I've received tons of emails and phone calls about Macro. Many of the emails have been positive. I worked with Macro. Macro helped an unsheltered person today get shelter. Or I get emails that say, Macro, where was Macro when I called? What's the number for Macro? Why isn't Macro doing this? Somebody was in a fight and Macro didn't show up. Macro doesn't show up for anything that's violent. So I say that to say I want to make sure that we are on the same page from the fire department to the community about what Macro does. When can you call Macro? How do you reach Macro? And how long will it take Macro to get there? And when they get there, what are they going to do? I want to make sure that we're on the same page so that we can grow Macro and use Macro as one of the leading ways of helping our citizens of Oakland. Whether it's somebody that's on the curb that needs some help, could use some services, or if it's something even bigger, don't hesitate to call. If it's something that needs to be elevated, Macro knows how to elevate it and get a fire engine or a fire truck on scene to give that care that needs to be given to the citizens. So I won't take a lot of time. I appreciate you showing up today. You should be very excited about your fire department. We're here to help in any way we can, and we look forward to serving you moving forward.
All right, thank you, Chief Covington. So there's some questions that relate to Macro that are about mental illness, and I think I'm gonna punt this one to Elliot, if that's okay, Chief Cove?
Yes.
Okay. So generally speaking, just how can you share with the folks here how Macro responds to mental illness and what happens if they are experiencing a neighbor or resident that's going through a mental health crisis and they call Macro, what can they expect to happen?
Well, thank you and good evening, everyone. My name is Elliot Jones, and I'm your Macro Program Manager within the Oakland Fire Department. Before I tell you what happens, let me tell you how to reach Macro. The best and most efficient way to reach Macro is by dialing the direct phone line, which is 510-44-MACRO, or 510-446-2276. This will take you to a Macro dispatcher within the Fire Dispatch Center, and they will direct that to a team to then respond. The second way to reach Macro, because remember, nothing should be an emergent, violent, or criminal instance. If it's truly non-emergent, non-violent, and non-criminal, we would imagine you have time to write an email. And you can send an email to macro@oaklandca.gov, and that goes directly to our teams in the field for a response. Email is also critical for us to develop a track record of an ongoing incident or challenge you may be having. And that way we can have multiple teams participate in alleviating this issue or incident.
That was his time, sorry.
Oh, oh man.
I offer some. But you can't rap, though. I have another one for you, so go ahead and.
And what you can expect when we respond, we deploy our teams throughout the city 7 days a week from 6:30 a.m. to 8:30 p.m. What you can expect in a matter of minutes is that a Macro team will respond. They will either communicate with you as the reporting party, but then they will shift their focus to the individual in need. Many times what we see and identify as a mental health crisis is not that severe. And if we truly want to keep calls from escalating to our police department or to our firefighters, we have to have different ways to address people that are on the verge or heading towards crisis. One thing that we will do is offer basic tools, water, food, some clothing, anything that can get you by, because we're trying to pull individuals back into shared reality. We understand that a little kindness can mean the difference between an ambulance having to come and see you are you being able to go on your way and hopefully down the road seek further help. Macro is still in its infancy, again, 2.5 years in, but I can tell you in the last 3 months, as we've added 18 new macro responders, macro teams have responded to 1,000 requests from Oakland residents. And that is now becoming the floor and not the ceiling. So we look forward to growing with you. We look forward to evolving. We look forward to being part of the public safety landscape for years to come and partnering with all these amazing people up here to serve the city.
Thank you so much, Elliot. So this one is very specific and is identifying that here in Chinatown, there tends to be folks who are experiencing mental health issues that come that are around early in the morning. So I heard you share with the folks that Macro gets up and going around 6:30 a.m., and that's pretty early. But what happens for folks who are identifying something before 6:30 a.m.? If they send an email, do you still come? What happens?
Two things. If you are able to see an email before we are in service at 0600 6 a.m., it will be, bless you, it'll be a record that we have, and as teams go in service, it'll be sent to the appropriate team. If you were to even call dispatch, and we are working on this, a dispatcher will take your call as early as 0600 6 a.m., and they will hold it for the teams to come in service. I would recommend, let's just speak for the area, and I know there's not just folks from Chinatown here. We have Eastlake, we have downtown, we have all over. If you see something early, let us know. If there's something that you pick up on your morning walk or on your way to work, please reach out to Macro. The earlier we can get to people, the better chance we have in not only encouraging them to take services or to change their position, but we can also head off potential health conflicts down the road. With the hot summer, if you see somebody that's out, not in the shade, looking like they're thirsty, give us a call. A bottle of water can be the difference between an ambulance ride followed by a fire truck. And that's resources we can't afford to risk or waste in the city.
Awesome, thank you so much. Okay, one more for you, Chief Covington. Can you explain why the fire department is increasing fire inspection fees on apartment complexes?
Increasing fees on only depending on the size of the apartment complex. Overall in the city, we have increased fees. We have a fee increase on all, pretty much all inspections. If you need to get permits, that's a citywide increase. But depending on the size of your apartment complex, there's a tiered system of what we charge for that inspection per the time the inspector needs to be there.
All right, so this question is related to human trafficking. Does Macro help with interrupting prostitution?
We do not.
They do not. That was a short answer. How can we get, so this one I think might be for you, Chief, but I'm just going to stick with the human trafficking theme here. So they're identifying like smoke shops and gift shops that are along the Blade that are catering to the sex trafficking market there. Are you aware of efforts to either close those businesses down and or just address them, code enforcement, et cetera?
Yeah, we have a unit that strictly looks at our alcohol, our weed grows, our tobacco businesses, and they do operations in these facilities throughout the city.
Yep. And I should say that on the Mayor's Advisory Council for Human Trafficking, which includes on the enforcement subcommittee, we have OPD, we have DVP, we have the DA's office, as well as probation. And this is something specifically that we're focused on. Every 2 weeks, we get a report back from OPD about what businesses have been engaged in order to address this. So thank you for bringing that up. Okay, this last one, and we're going to get into the presentation, is just generally about the role of the county. I think, Mary, I've heard you share this a lot, that not one single agency, government, or jurisdiction can address the many issues that we're facing. So the question is, what's the role of Alameda County in providing social services and working towards crime prevention? I also know Chief Joshi, you might know a little bit about this with the county's efforts on violence prevention, but if you can just start on what you think the county needs to do in order to support the city.
Yes, and so is the first thing that you need to know is that there is a board of supervisors at the county. The board of supervisors, they draw money down for the city of Oakland and other cities in the county around social services. We do not have a public health department, so they get money for public health. They get money for the services that are supposed to be provided to our unhoused community. And so what we need for the county to do is really to step up to help us in regards to, you know, how we, let's just take an example, homelessness, right? I've charged the grand jury to get involved in understanding the equity piece around the resources, the dollars that we, the city of Oakland, is getting. Not the equal amount of money that every city is going to get from the county due to their population. Oakland gets more money than all the other cities already currently right now, according to our population, because we are the largest city in Alameda County. However, is it equitable, right? Right now, a lot of the county programs are actually set up here in the city of Oakland. So if somebody who was unhoused, for example, in Hayward, applied to get into shelter, and there is opening in Oakland, they will place that Hayward resident in Oakland. Therefore, our number of unhoused increases, right? And that gets counted towards against us. At the same time, other cities are not standing up programs in their cities, yet they're still drawing down on this money for homeless services. And so I'm pushing to put pressure on the county to give us the equitable amount of money. But at the same time, we have to make sure that we are taking care of our own first. We cannot actually, you know, take care of everybody, and all the mayors have to step up and help the region as a whole to solve this housing crisis by, one, building affordable, deeply affordable housing, and then by, two, standing up their own shelter, their own safe parking spaces. We cannot, as Oaklanders, continue to take on the burden with amongst all the other cities in the county. We can't do that. And so this is a long, drawn-out process, but that is the job of the county, is to really tackle and provide the services for social services, for welfare services, and also for public health.
All right, and I'll just add, just to move us along, that Alameda County recently created, is it an Office of Violence Prevention, that is giving funds out to grantees, I think it's $5 million. And so that's a recent development in the last year or two, and I know Chief Joshi has been in conversation with them. Chief Joshi also is a funder, or the department is, to various organizations that do social service type of work or services for our residents. Okay, so we're gonna now pivot to our clean part of the program. I'm gonna introduce our director here, Harold Duffy. Harold Duffy joined the city, and then we're gonna get to DOT. They're gonna do back-to-back presentations. So we're getting to homelessness and illegal dumping, as well as transportation. So, Harold Duffy joined the city as the director of Oakland Public Works in July of 2021, bringing robust experience in public services to the city of Oakland. In his new role as assistant city administrator, Duffy's immediate assignments include developing a horizontal and vertical capital improvement program to enhance the city's capital project delivery, as well as encampment management operations, which is being realigned to focus more on infrastructure services. I know this is a topic that everyone's waiting to hear about. We have the governor's order. We have the Supreme Court ruling that has changed, and so folks are interested in hearing about this, how that will impact Oakland's approach. And then we have, well, I'll let you go first, and then I'll introduce Josh. And you have 4 minutes. Thanks.
Great. Thank you. Good evening, everyone. And I want to say thank you for being here tonight. I do want to say that it's also very important to acknowledge all of the help in which you provide the City of Oakland. I say that because I want to start off by saying this. The City of Oakland has a $2.2 billion budget. But in addition to that budget, there's funding like Measure U, Measure KK. Those items are things that you approved as voters to help us run the city. So one of the things that Brooklyn mentioned earlier was I'm responsible for vertical and horizontal building of infrastructure. So every library, every community center, all those things like that, and plus working with Josh on the road infrastructure. That's one of my business lines. The other business line is illegal dumping. The other business line is encampment management. So how many people in here have trash service at their home? should be everybody. Because here's the thing, as a resident, if you don't have trash service, the city will sign you up for trash service and make you pay more for the trash service. So the big question is this, if everybody, every resident has trash service, where's all this trash coming from? Last year, the Public Works Department picked up 20,000 tons of trash, illegally dumped trash, in the city of Oakland. That's about 35 pounds for every Oakland resident that we're dealing with mentally and physically on our streets. Where is all this trash coming from? If I ask the same question to businesses, and I say, how many businesses in the city of Oakland have trash service? It would be 85 to 90% of those businesses actually have trash service. So those 10% of the businesses that are in business that are generating trash, what are they doing with their trash? We're seeing that. We know exactly where what's happening with that trash. It's going on our city streets. So what can you do to help us? If you guys have a property or if you own a multifamily unit and you're getting ready to hire somebody, and that guy, you see that guy in that pickup truck with those boards on the side of the truck, and he says, I'll haul this stuff away for you. I'll haul it away for $50. Well, guess what he's going to do with that? He's going to pick up that stuff, take it down the street, and dump it in your neighborhood. And so guess the other problem with that, too, is this. When he dumps that stuff in your neighborhood and it's got your name on it, we're coming after you. So what we ask you to do is do this. If you hire somebody like that, do not pay them until they bring you those dump slips from the dump. And also, what you can do, too, is take advantage of the city's free bulky item collection program. Call Waste Management. And so tonight I have props because Warren Chu is here. Raise your hand for Waste Management. Have any questions about bulk item collection, anything, we can help you out. On the other side of the house, I have Kristen Hathaway. Raise your hand. Kristen is the Assistant Director of Public Works, and she's in charge of Bureau of Environment, which is all maintenance of all parks, maintenance of all city facilities, and also administration of the solid waste contract with Warren Chu over in Waste Management. So, the city of Oakland's employees said they pick up 20,000 tons of material. And so that 20,000 tons is actually picked up by about 60 employees within Kristen's organization. And so they are doing a great job, but here's what our problem is. They pick it up, somebody puts it down. They pick it up, somebody puts it down. Was that my cue?
Sir.
Oh,
yes, sir.
I didn't hear that. So anyway, no. And so what we need to do is make sure that we go to the area of enforcement. That's going to be the next big key for us. And also, let me jump to the other important thing, and I'm sure Brooklyn will allow me to do this because the mayor has given me specific instructions to talk to you about encampment management. And she mentioned earlier about Grants Pass, and I want to tell you before Grants Pass, there was Martin B. Voisey. And what that said was that even the city had this great encampment management policy. But the federal government came in and said, no, you must offer a bed to every single person before you shut down their encampment. And the city couldn't do that. But Grant Pass overturned that. And now the mayor has told staff what she wants to do is make sure that we focus in on returning ADA access to our city streets, to return public property parks back to our city streets, to remove those barriers where there are encampments near 50 feet of residents and also businesses. And so we are getting ready to really focus in on that. We are still going to be humane in our process. We're going to offer somebody a place to go, okay? But they have to go. If they don't want to accept, that's fine. They cannot be creating hazards to our infrastructure. They cannot be risking our neighborhoods with danger. So the mayor has given staff that clear direction, and you'll see results in that within the next 30 days.
All right, thank you so much. Okay, so I'm just gonna shoot some questions for you right now, and some of these are directed towards you, Mayor. I think Director Duffy or City Administrator Duffy talked about how you've given him mandates and your partnership. So I know you all meet weekly and you're partnering very closely. So you can either answer them or if Mayor, if you want to. But this question, you answered some of it right now. I think folks wanted to know what the plan is moving forward with these new laws changing. So I feel like you've addressed that. This is saying, you know, we all know the difference between when you enter San Leandro or Alameda, right? And you just instantly see that there's different levels of enforcement. So what are our ordinances around homelessness, trash, encampments and stuff? And are they being mandated or followed? Like, how are they being enforced?
So, you know, let me just kind of address that first part of the question about you go in from Oakland to San Leandro or Berkeley or it's a, here's what happens to the city of Oakland. Since we are the largest city, and there's something called a temporary restraining order. What we do is we post 14 days in advance that we're going to go out and clean up this encampment. We go out there, and we get ready to do the encampment. We get served by a federal judge saying, you can't do this encampment. You've got to work with the people, do X, X, Y, and Z. So we're beyond that now. And we are now moving forward to move more quickly in terms of trying to address the encampments. So that's one hurdle that we're over now that we're really focusing in on. We don't have to provide a certain type of bed to individuals. We can provide them what we have in order to close down the encampment. And there was And one of the problems that we have also is that people are confused with when we say illegal dumping and homeless encampments. If an encampment says, someone in the encampment says, that trash is mine, that used to become their property. So that created some issues for us. But we do try to separate the two, but we often have problems with having to leave the material there because the unhoused person claims it as their own. But our stats show that every true illegal dumping request that we get through Ultimate One, we actually go out and we pick that up within 3 to 5 days. Now, I say to you, I understand you might have some consternation about that, by the way the city looks, but it's because some of that stuff is actually related to a homeless encampment where we've had to wait in more detailed time before we can get that material. But I'm saying to you is that under the new federal order, we are able to, I think, to be much quicker in the near future.
All right, excellent, thank you. So there's a question here about basically this person sees that our homeless population falls into two camps, those who have substance abuse issues and those that don't, and think that some of the models that we're implementing now work better for the ones who don't have substance abuse issues. So the question is there a difference in the plan? Like what happens with homeless folks that we're engaging, either in encampments or otherwise, who are suffering from substance abuse? What's the model there?
So one of the most important things to understand, when you look at an encampment and there's an encampment on the street, if that encampment stays there, there's very little hope of transitioning people from the street getting permanent affordable housing. The first thing that we do in every encampment, we send out outreach. And what outreach does is they try to pair people with services. If they have substance abuse, if they have medical conditions, all of that stuff is logged and registered. And then we work with the county to try to first get them from the street into temporary shelter. Then when they're in shelter, they're given an opportunity to do wraparound services and programs. Then from that point, they are then told how to fill out a housing plan, getting all their paperwork together, understanding the process of moving from the housing plan, from temporary shelter, into permanent affordable housing. And I want you to know that the city of Oakland has spent over $200 million in terms of creating that final housing, affordable housing plan. So our approach isn't haphazard, move people along. Our approach is take them from the street, give them temporary shelter, have them do a connection with wraparound services with the county, provide them with a housing plan, and having them end up with a permanent affordable housing. I do want to note that the city of Oakland is 29% of the Alameda County population. but the city of Oakland has 58% of the shelter beds and 58% of the unhoused with our 29% population. So we are carrying the burden of the county in trying to address this particular issue.
All right, thank you so much. I'm going to rattle off a few more. So this one is this one was interesting to me. So they're talking about there's code enforcement, there's all sorts of enforcements for apartment buildings, for houses. Can these encampments also be held to some kind of code or some kind of similar standard? These folks are dealing with fires that impact their buildings or their living spaces, and so maybe this is for you, Cub, I don't know, but how are encampments regulated, or are there any codes related to that?
For encampments? There should be no encampments.
Right? Yeah, but it's saying many encampments are fire, health, and plumbing hazards. My apartment is subject to annual inspection. Why aren't their homes held to similar standards?
Yeah, let's just be clear. I mean, I'll let the fire chief answer the inspection part of it. That's the legalese, but just coming from a layperson, right, the encampments won't pass that inspection. So the goal here is that it's not dignified to allow for people to live in tents outside. I was homeless before with my son, and not once did I ever was looking for a plot of land or dirt to pitch a tent. It's not dignified. We have to get people into shelter, but it's gonna be a multi-pronged approach. We have to, from the state itself, Prop 1 that just passed last year, that's going to allow for monies early next year to become available so that we can build up the permanent supportive housing. So under the Reagan administration, they took down all of like our mental health housing, right? Our permanent supportive housing, because many of the people who live on the streets cannot actually live alone. They need permanent supportive housing. And so that money is gonna be able to build that up, but that's gonna take time. And so what we are needing to do right now is really push upon the county to give us the fair share of resources, and not just that, but demand that other cities stand up their own homeless shelters, demand that they stand up their own safe parking, because again, we are carrying the burden for the whole county, and that is not okay, it's not appropriate.
Thank you, Mayor. Okay, so these next few questions, and again, I'm gonna encourage us to be succinct, two or three sentences, or more or less. So specifically, what is being done to address the state of Lake Merritt? We have folks who are talking about crime there, but also litter, et cetera. What's the plan with Lake Merritt? What's being done to beautify it and protect our jewel?
Sure. We actually just had a cleanup with Lake Merritt for housing, homeless, and encampment sweep this week. We have the area broken down into four distinct areas. We did area 1 and 2. That would be from Grand Bellevue all the way over to Lakeshore. So you should see some. We did some postings. We removed several people from the encampments in the particular area. The Public Works Department actually provides funding for the Lake Merritt Institute of about $1 million a year to help clean up the lake, and also provides funding for others. The Public Works Department, you can talk with Kristen, they are responsible for the maintenance of that particular park. They've actually got a robust schedule in terms of mowing schedule, maintenance schedule. So I would continue to use Oak 311 if I were you, to make sure that your service requests are answered from the Public Works Department.
All right, the next kind of place-based question is about Wilma Chan Park. Folks are feeling like her name's not being honored in the state that the park is in right now. So what's being done around improvements for Wilma Chan Park, if you know of any?
Yes, so Wilma Chan Park, I think most recently, about 4 or 5 months ago, there was a makeshift gambling shack there, and we went through and we cleaned up the area. I think that there are going to be more efforts to kind of go through. What Public Works are doing right now is they're going through and they're looking at maintenance schedules for all of the parks, along with their Measure Q funding. So you should see some differences in that in the future. If you have any more questions, you can talk with Kristen. She'll be here after the meeting.
All right, thank you so much. Okay, so let's move to transportation. We do have, not as many, two or three for transportation, and then we can try to get to any others that we have remaining. some that are not related to necessarily clean and safe, but we want to try to get to. And again, if we don't get to your individual question, you will get an answer via email. This hardworking team that's going around is going to make sure that we follow up with you good folks. So let me quickly introduce our new Director of Transportation, Josh Rowan. He assumed this position in April of 2024 and brings a rich set of leadership skills and experience. He came to us via Atlanta DOT, where he set up a new city department by consolidating technical resources from four different operating units. And so I know that was a brief introduction. Director Josh Rowan, Department of Transportation, please give him a warm welcome.
No, great. I appreciate that. Let me pull this out. I feel weird leaning down into the microphone. Again, Josh Rowan, happy to present from the Oakland Department of Transportation. Just have two slides tonight. Think of us as really two sides of a coin. The first you're very familiar with, streets and sidewalks. We have a team that's very committed to the work they do. I want to just show you some quick numbers to prove that to you. If you look from 2008 to 2018, City of Oakland paved about 100 miles. That's a very significant amount of paving. The team in the last 4 months paved 40 miles. So that's 4 years worth of work in the last 4 months. So an incredible amount of work being done. If you look again in that same 10-year period, 80,000 potholes were repaired. In the last fiscal year, your team at the Oakland Department of Transportation repaired 53,000. So very, very pleased with the performance that is going on. The emerging side of the Oakland Department of Transportation is actually on the public health and safety side. And especially here in the Chinatown area, there are some unique characteristics. I would share, I live near here. My son is attending Lincoln Elementary. His favorite location in Oakland is actually the public library, right here where we sit. And so we know firsthand the challenges that walking with regional traffic, with some of the speeding in this area present. And so if you aren't familiar with the Oakland-Alameda connectivity project, there's a $120 million infrastructure project that's coming to this area next spring. Get familiar with that because the benefits in this area will be tremendous. I'll wrap up quickly with, there was discussion earlier about cameras. There will be, so the Oakland Department of Transportation is partnering with the state to pilot speed enforcement cameras. It's a pilot project. It has nothing to do with the police department. It is run by the DOT, and there will be a camera placement on 7th between Broadway and Franklin. And so we actually have to prove to the state that these cameras are reducing speeding. So there's a lot of activity that's coming in this area, and I wish I could go to every town hall and announce $120 million worth of construction spending over 3 years. So again, very, very exciting times for the work that's happening in this area.
All right, thank you, Director Rowan. We have some Chinatown-specific questions. Starting with parking in Chinatown is difficult. They're talking about the $91 ticket that you get for parking in the yellow zone. And I think they're questioning why we have the yellow zones when parking is so difficult.
Yeah, so you know, it's interesting. Oakland, when it comes to parking, we have a door-to-door mindset. Again, I'm pretty familiar with this area. There's still quite a bit of parking around here. You may have to park down the street or a block away. The yellow zones are posted for loading and unloading. Those are business-related items. What I'm seeing that's more troubling is a lot of parking citywide that's happening in our red zones. And we're going to be getting more serious about the red zone parking. But we do focus on this area because we want to have orderly parking throughout the city. And so those are the parking ordinances in Oakland, and we want to have orderly parking that is happening, especially here in Chinatown.
All right. Thank you, Director. We have some specific locations in this area that have been pointed out that we'll make sure to get to you so that you can take that into consideration. One other question related to this specific area is that folks are asking if they can get permit parking for residents. That they're saying the $3 per hour for residents isn't fair, and other areas like Piedmont and Lake Merritt have parking permits for residents. So is that possible for Chinatown?
Let's have that conversation offline. You're exactly right that where the houses don't have the driveways and all you have is metered parking, that's something we need to discuss, certainly.
All right, so if you're still here who wrote this question, I won't out you. Director Owen will be here afterwards if you want to come. And actually, everyone will be here for a few minutes afterwards. I know it's late, it's Friday, but folks will be available. Okay, so downtown, question. When is DOT going to put in deterrence or stop speeding downtown and also address some of the donuts that take place in the intersection? So what's the plan for downtown around speeding and donuts?
So specific to downtown, there are some areas that are especially problematic that we're actually looking at potentially piloting street closures. Could we close sections of the street and just simply not allow the traffic to use them, start interfering with that flow of traffic? Now, we have to work very closely with our partners in the city, with police and fire, to make sure that we can maintain services, but we're looking at taking extreme actions such as road closures to start limiting those behaviors. What the side shows, historically, the traffic engineering perspective has been, that's not our job. We design intersections. We don't really get into intersections to interfere with the unlawful behavior. Now, we also understand that answer is totally unsatisfactory. And so our team has developed some designs that we believe will interfere with this behavior. Next week, we're going to test build a few of those at our maintenance facility. And so through the month of September, we're going to start implementing those in various intersections. If you'd like a preview, take a look at Foothills at Seminary. We did an experiment out there trying to basically change the surface of the street to interfere with the donuts. And so we're taking a more aggressive posture to say, what can we do as engineers to change either the configuration or change the surface to disrupt this behavior? Because it's causing such physical and emotional distress within the city. And it needs to stop and go away.
All right, thank you. Last question for you, Director Owen, at least for now. We approved $600 million bond for potholes, and I know you just talked about all the paving that's been happening, but anything you can speak to specifically to potholes, and why do we have so many potholes?
Yeah, I certainly can. If I go back to my time in Atlanta, there's been a wide range of years where Oakland was known nationally as having the worst streets in the United States of America. Your pavement quality index was in the 40s, and that's through sheer neglect. And so because of, as ACA Duffy said, because of the people in Oakland doing things such as approving Measure KK and Measure U, you've approved the funding to go into the paving. And so in the last 6 years, the Oakland Department of Transportation has paved roughly, we've updated the numbers from this presentation, it's roughly about 30% of the city streets, which is very significant. Now, there's still a lot of work to do. So we're looking at another 15 to 18 years to get caught up. But when you've ignored your paving for two generations, it's going to take time to rebuild the streets. I would also offer, when I gave you the number that we repaired 53,000 potholes, that's also an indicator of the decay on the existing streets. That's a very high number. And so while we're performing well with the repairs, That's a lot of potholes. And so the key is to continue the paving. We believe, so this last year was our best year. We hit 47 miles in the year. We believe we can hit 55 to 60. And if we can maintain that over a 10-year period, a lot's going to get done. And so we thank you for that support, but understand that this type of effort doesn't happen over a 2 or 3 year period when it's been ignored for decades.
All right, thank you so much. Okay, so at this time, I'm going to speed us through a few that didn't quite neatly fall into the three buckets that we're discussing, being encampments and illegal dumping, transportation and safety, but are related. Obviously, everything's related. So one of the questions, Mayor, this is for you around the Coliseum deal. Folks want to know what's the status of the Coliseum deal, understanding how it's impacting the current budget. And so that would start, and then there's a follow-up.
Okay, so the Coliseum deal, we've been working on, again, it was owned by two different entities. It was half of it's owned by the city, half of it's owned by the county. There's not an actual line of where the half is. It's just generally half of it's the city, half of it's the county. About three maybe 3.5 years ago, the county sold their half to the A's. And so now the A's is the owner of their half. And then with the city, you know, nothing could get developed there because of the fact that there's, you know, multiple owners. And so with the city, we're working with the African American Sports Entertainment Group, who are locally from Oakland, working with Loop Capital, who is the capital venture, the venture capitalist. It's also, it's very historical. It's Black-owned venture capitalists working with Black family-based Oakland entrepreneurs here in the city of Oakland. And so that's important to me because we want to make sure that we have the Oakland values. And we also want to make sure that it does get developed once we sell it. So with that being said, being that we're in a huge budget deficit due to, you know, the pandemic and other reasons, just like many other cities are suffering through in the state, this came at a time where, as we're filling these budget deficit, we had to make a decision, right? Do we sell this piece of land? We were already moving forward to sell it, but then now it's like, do we take the proceeds to plug in the hole so that we can save public safety? Basically, what that means is, I've said yes, we need to plug the hole so that we can save public safety and figure out a solution for our long term. Because right now we're funded for 678 officers. Without this plug-in, we will go down all the way to 610 officers. And that's going to make it very hard to keep Oaklanders safe. Not just that, but at the same time we're bringing down officers to 610, if we didn't do this plan, we would also be closing down 4 fire stations. And then not just that, but we would have to be laying off city workers who are picking up your trash. And so that is all too much. You know, this is a balancing game, right? And so when it comes to a crisis such as this, this is allowable by our charter to allow for a one-time use of funds to plug in the hole so that we can figure out how we're going to solve this long-term solution. So being that we inherited this issue, we are working very closely with the African American Sports and Entertainment Group. You may have heard that yesterday they already signed their purchase and sell agreement, which is the very last step with the Oakland A's. So they have the A's half already. So we are working diligently, and we will be able to announce something by early next week about where we're at with the city and our PSA. So it's very good news, and we're excited to have one owner of the site so that we can finally develop it. And once we develop it, then this is going to start the insurgence of that economic development so that we can get new monies to come into Oakland, keep all the services that we currently have right now, but just add on more services. Now we can pay for new services. And so that's the goal of ensuring that we're in a more stable condition as we move forward in the city of Oakland.
Thank you, Mayor. One other question related to the budget. What kind of mitigations or what's been done to ensure that the city doesn't miss out on any other additional grants or funds coming into the city? I know that the city has received millions and millions of dollars since that, but what has been put into place? And I know we don't have our city administrator here tonight who would answer that. I know he's been working on that. What do you know about that?
Absolutely. And so the thing with the city of Oakland, you know, I am the CEO, and then I hire a city administrator, Mr. Justin Johnson. He really wanted to be here today, but he couldn't be here. And he is in charge of all the departments. Chief Mitchell actually has multiple bosses, and that's myself and Justin, the city administrator. And so with that being said, you know, we know that we missed out on this grant because of the inability for the city to interconnect the different departments. We knew this was already a weakness in the city. When I was on the city council, we saw this was a weakness. So we put aside money to fund a centralized grant person. And so during this time, we had already funded the position. We were just going through the interviews. And so during this time, the worst happened, which is, you know, the connection between the economic workforce development and the police department did not connect, and the application did not get pushed through at its full expense. And so therefore, we did miss out on the application, but now that centralized grant person is actually in place. And so this is going to help deter any of those possibilities of us forgetting to apply for a grant or what have you, because there's going to be that connection.
All right. Thank you, Mayor. There is a question. I know you just did a visit down here recently, but what's being done to support the Malonga Center?
Yes, and so the Malonga Center is a very unique and a treasure of ours. It is owned by the City of Oakland. This is where we host a lot of our artists and a lot of our camps. We actually, it's also housing at the very top. There's a bunch of SROs that are meant for artists. But, however, because it is a city facility and we are in a deficit, for many decades now, the Malonga Center has been not upkept, right, by the city. And so what that means is there's, I believe that there's also mold in one of the rooms. And so there's going to be a lot of monies that need to go into that. But I'm already in deep conversation with different investors to reimagine what this place could look like, still keeping it an art form, you know, true to its value. But what we are doing is that we are getting in, not just investors, but people, the Bloomberg organization is giving me, has given me three full-time employees on their dime to ensure that we create the Black Arts Movement and Business District here. Right now, we have that on the 14th Street. However, nobody knows that that's the case. It's only on the books, right, that it's the Black Arts Movement Business District, and that's not okay. And so we're gonna, while we are revamping that whole space to make it so that it is that legendary, you know, Black Movement and Arts District, Malanga Center is gonna be a part of that project too, to be revisioned.
All right, so we're gonna do a couple more. I know we got a little bit of a late start, so thank you for bearing with us. This one is about our small businesses, and I know that's something that's near and dear to your heart. How will the city help small businesses in Oakland sustain?
You know, this is a really great question. I know that we went through a really tough couple of, or a few years, even through the pandemic, around the bipping, you know, around, you know, the crime that was happening, you know, and then that really deterred our customers from coming out to really spend money. But what we also saw was that the result of the pandemic was that a lot of people were working from home. In downtown Oakland, we didn't suffer as badly as other neighboring cities where it was just all, you know, office space. We do have a residential front here. However, it's not enough. And so what we're doing on our city is the city administrator is working closely with our city workers to tell them that we all have to come back to work, right? We all have to come back to work. You know, we're working closely with what we call the Big Four. That is the Big Four who have the most hires in Oakland. That's PG&E, Edmund, you know, Blue Shield, Kaiser, and Clorox. That's actually five, but, you know, so all of these organizations to really push them to also bring their workers back into the office. And that's how we're going to support small businesses. More so than that, one thing I know that you're pushing me to go faster, is that here in Old Oakland, we're looking at how do we, to your point, how do we close down streets and then also program it with live music or what have you to really attract people to come down. And it's like, knowing that when you close down these streets to have these like more activation downtown, we have to provide parking, safe parking where you know you're not going to get bipped. And so with that being said, we are looking into, so we're still going out to get community feedback or what have you, but as an example would be Old Oakland, where we already have a closure on Fridays for the farmers market. If we had a permanent closure there and worked in partnership with the Marriott to utilize their garage, right? You can't bip in their garage because you really can't get in that easily. And so if we can utilize their garage as a partner and then close down Old Oakland and then activate it with different performances or what have you, can we bring more people to come to downtown, at least in that space, where they can feel safe because there's not car traffic and it's not easy to actually victimize people? So those are some of the ideas. If you have other ideas, we're more than happy to take those ideas. A lot of the things that we are doing under this administration is very innovative. And so that's how we got to the Baller Stadium. That was from two constituents who came to me, who had an idea. I gave them a list of things that they needed to go do, including go find their own investors to pay for it. They found the investors, they came back and did all of their homework. And then what the city did was we stepped up to help them in partnership to make it a real thing. And so we invite you all to come with your ideas. And if it's packed fully, we're more than happy to work with you to make it a real asset to the city.
So speaking of residents' ideas, I know you talked about the Coliseum sale, which is being led by folks who have deep roots in East Oakland. What is being done to improve the Hagenberger Corridor between the Coliseum and the airport?
So the Hagenberger Corridor.
And safety specifically is the question.
So I did one thing. What I was trying to do is to get the port of Oakland to absorb the whole Hagenberger Corridor. They already contract with the Sheriff's Department to patrol the airport. And so why not extend it to the whole corridor? Unfortunately, the Sheriff's Department they don't have capacity for that. They don't have enough sheriffs. And so if you know anybody who wants to apply to be a sheriff, please apply. Or OPD. Or fire.
We do have some academies coming up.
Yes. We have many academies.
Yes.
Because in law enforcement, we're at a standstill, so we're encouraging a lot of people to apply. However, with that being said, because they don't have capacity for it, this is my priority corridor. It is embarrassing that people are getting off of the airplane, visitors, and they're going through that corridor. Right. It is. So what we're doing is this piece of selling the Coliseum is going to inject the economy, because as things get activated there, we're going to go out, the whole team, to beautify that space, to figure out how we beautify that space so that we can attract more businesses. But once the Coliseum gets developed and the news get around that there's only one owner and it's going to really happen, finally, after decades of talking about it, the business will come. And we're hoping that this corridor is going to be the revenue generating corridor that we have always knew it could be. So that is my number one priority corridor.
Thank you, Mayor. And I'll just add on behalf of Chief Mitchell that our DC of that area and Area 6 in particular does have a special focus on the Hegenberger Corridor, including foot patrols as well as community ambassadors that have been funded for there. Okay, last question before we do some calls to action and close out with appreciation. Who on the panel, or does everyone on the panel, know the official motto of Oakland? What's our motto? All right, Mayor said it first, love life. Hopefully you all know that too. I also heard Chief Covington. And maybe you didn't hear my question, everyone, but for our new folks, our motto in Oakland, the city of Oakland, is love life. So with that being said, I'd like to thank you all for showing some love to Oakland by coming here tonight. Please give yourselves a warm round of applause. We have two very quick calls to action. AC alerts. Please sign up for AC alerts if you haven't already. It's very important to get emergency alerts in cases of emergency and to stay connected to that information. The other one is the Adopt-A-Spot, right? So where is Adopt-A-Spot? Outside?
They're outside okay. The lobby.
Okay. So can I do it really quickly? Yes. All right. So Adopt-A-Spot, this is a new city program. It's part of Oakland Fresh. And what that means is that the city will come out if you register. They'll do an initial clean of the spot. And then what you do is commit to keeping it clean, so that we don't have just the return. We go and clean it up, someone else comes and does something. And the city will provide the materials, whatever those materials are that are needed, will allow folks to borrow them. And so if you want to sign up for your neighborhood or for your block to adopt a spot, you can find those good folks outside to do that. And then the final is just make sure you put your email down for us so that we can stay connected to you. Hopefully you found this information really helpful and productive, and we want to keep the conversation going. So thank you so much again for coming out, and a warm round of applause for our city leaders. Everyone have a safe Labor Day weekend. Thank you so much. Have a great evening.